Okay, shalom, Rastafari. Greetings. Welcome. I am Alonso, and let's continue on Rastafari sabbatical study number 46. Wrap things up. Hopefully, I fully just conclude. It's way past the Sabbath, but nonetheless, it's important information. And so let us continue. We left off speaking on molten, how it's casting with metal and pouring out, like anointing and honoring. So pouring out the metal and creating these machines and machinery, maquinaria, and related to machina and mezquine, and so making that connection, how they devalue humanity and the work of a man's hand, because materials or products are produced more cheaply. And so continuing with that, let's just being that molten described a calf and round and revolve, so we could even go as far as making the connection of the Industrial Revolution, what's going on, the pattern. Well, a revolve or to revolve and to revolutionize is also patterns, right? And round and revolving, everything revolves around machinery nowadays, you know? So, as I mentioned, learn a trade, learn how to work with your hands, and you should have no problem surviving, you know. And this just came up. I just thought of this. Well, I didn't just think of this, right? But it came to, and I was, I'm able to receive that. I'd like to mention how not only learn a trade, but learn how to be a phenomena. Learn how to bear fruit from yourselves, in the sense that let's not rely on material substance that is not always there, or that it in itself requires other substances in order to function. So, for instance, us as Rastafari, we can work with anything that is natural, because it'll always be there. For instance, I guess this isn't the best example, but as like a hammer, you know, we have to make the transition to where we can't rely on a hammer, because the hammer might not always be there. So to expand and open our minds to use our creativity and resolve these issues, which aren't really issues, it's just a matter of transitioning from a hammer and grabbing that stone over there. And pile and driving the stake across the ground, you know, or something, whatever. And some might think that this is foolish, but it's really not, because in most of society, if they don't have a hammer, in reality, what's going to end up happening is they're not going to complete the task, because and they're going to, you know, just lie there idly. And whenever I don't know, let's say it's their boss or whatever, and he's going to go check on progress, the individual most likely in this society and worldwide is gonna answer, well, there was no hammer, you know, like well, I didn't have a hammer, so there was nothing I could do about it. And so goes to show the extent of foolishness within our system. And so yeah, so to make a transition and to kind of like use fruit as well, use fruit and phenomena in the sense that we affect something out of ourselves, you know, like if certain tools aren't there, we ourselves affect that and continue with that, because we don't rely on tools, we rely on the inner self and the gift, you know, the many gifts that Jag is so kind enough to bestow upon Dai and Dai. And so we use that creativity, and so it allows us to not stumble across like nonsense, you know. So just throwing that out there, but let us continue. So calf, let us define calf. Blue Letter Bible Dictionary says that calf is a, there's two kinds of calf, a first year calf and a third year calf. The first year calf is tender and is broken into and worked and flexible. And that would be like Ai and Dai. Jah want that. Jah want Ai and Dai not to be stubborn. He wants to mold us and form us to to what he originally intended us to be. And the third year calf would be like our governors and leaders and stuff like that. Like, they're not broken into, they're not right, they're not accustomed, they don't know. Like, it's like, because it even goes as far as mentioning the leaders of the world, you know. And I can't recall exactly what was behind that, but it, we don't even have to go there, because we already know that the leaders of this world are fools, you know, of the greatest kind, you know. And so let us continue by, well, you know, let us, as far as the main Bible chapters for this, for RSS number 46, let us conclude there. I just want to add that in From Babylon to Timbuktu, it is written, and it's, I think the chapter is called Moses's Foreshadowing. And I'm gonna add this because it's interesting. So the daughter of Pharaoh finds Moses in the river, and she draws him out, and so she decides to take Moses and raise him up in Pharaoh's house, right? And Pharaoh loves his daughter so much that he's not willing to hurt her. And then when the daughter takes Moses to show off to Pharaoh, one of Pharaoh's astronomers or magicians, one of his prophets, he notices that's the child that is to be born, and that is gonna destroy the kingdom, the empire of Egypt. And the sign is that when the daughter of Pharaoh comes out with Moses and Pharaoh greets them, Pharaoh puts on a diadem on Moses, and that would be like a headband, but a golden, like a crown. And Moses grabs that and he stamps it, and that's what caught my attention. He stamped it. Just, that's the exact same word that's used when to describe when Moses stamped the golden calf, you know, crushed it and beat upon it and turned it into dust even. And so, and when the prophet of Moses saw that, the prophet let Pharaoh know, like, that's the one. He's, that what he just did to the crown, he's gonna do to the kingdom, to the system. But Pharaoh had already promised that he wasn't gonna hurt Moses, because, you know, he loves his daughter so much. So they end up putting up with it. Moses becomes educated. He's like educated and knowledgeable on everything. And so later on, you know, they don't know how to get rid of Moses, and so they give Moses the position of general, and they send him to go south to fight the Nubians, to fight Ethiopians, so in hopes of Moses being killed in action, right, and during war. And but that kind of backfires, because all the Hebrews kind of get excited, because one of their own kind is exalted to the position of general. So right off the bat, you know, it backfired on them. So Moses takes, you know, he heads south, he's gonna go to war, and him being so knowledgeable and being able to act on that knowledge, he decides not to go by the way of the Nile River, because if by doing so, he knew that it would be highly fortified and that the Ethiopians would have that area well protected. So what Moses does, he goes through the wilderness. Now, the wilderness was not the safest way, because there were these creatures known as flying serpents, and we can directly make the association with the fiery serpents that that appear in scripture and to bite many of Moses's people. And so, well, Jah's people, but, you know, under the leadership of Moses. And so I'm just going to continue, and we'll go into that. So Moses, he did this because he, you know, him being so knowledgeable and being able to act on that knowledge, what he does is he brings along baskets full of ibis, which are birds that eat these flying serpents. And so whenever the flying serpents just pop out of nowhere, I'm thinking they're like, these kind of serpents or snakes that they dwell in trees, and they just, it's not that they fly, it's they kind of spring themselves or kind of like push themselves off the or impulse, how do you call that? Like they they kind of like impulse themselves from off the tree and land on their enemy, right? On their whatever it is that they're gonna eat or something. And so Moses has a whole bunch of birds, ibes, and he lets them loose. Surely enough, the ibes are having the time of their lives. It's a feeding frenzy. And so Moses gets across the wilderness, and he reaches this highly fortified area that appears to be like an island. And I'm thinking Lalibela. I'm thinking like the Jordan River in the rainy season, when Ethiopians were faithful, when Jah, because Jah mentions in RSS 46 that don't worry about anything. If you keep the commandments, you'll get your rain. You won't have to drink any other kind of water but rainwater. And so that's what's going on. That's what I think is going on. So I'm imagining like the River Jordan of Lalibela, and then like and then Moses approaching Lalibela, and being the rainy season and stuff, and so there's raging waters coming through the River Jordan, and then there's the rock foundation, because Moses mentions that it was like a, I guess like a fort or a foundation so strong that even when the waters were like, when the violent waters passed through, that they didn't do so much as even shake the ground, And so I'm thinking Lalibela, and what ends up happening is that it's kind of like a, like no one's proceeding. They're at a standstill. And so what I'm thinking is, not thinking, but from Babylon to Timbuktu goes on to mention how I think it's the queen that sets eye on Moses, and she's kind of like a, she kind of gets this crush, we could say, or she ends up like she's attracted to Moses, and so they end up bargaining for peace. They get married, they like each other. They it's like a home run, you could say. Like they hit they it just works out, and so they don't even have to fight anymore. So now they're Moses has made peace with Ethiopia, and he brings along a wife. And so at this time, Egypt is being run by Ramses or something. It's been many years, and when Moses comes back triumphant, the Pharaoh and them are even more upset because they send him off in hopes of him dying, And so that's that story. So I just wanted to include that because I'm thinking the flying serpents in the wilderness are some of these individuals that exalt themselves and fly off into make-believe land and start pretending something is when in fact it is completely not. And so I'm thinking like, cause, and I think that because Einda is gonna reference the Qebra Negesh. Now, if you go to the chapter of lying witnesses, which would be kind of like a flying serpent, that's what I'm thinking. And so it's the story of Carmen, and we can even relate this to karma. So the story of Carmen is that Carmen is a good individual. He's well gifted by Jah, and because he does good, and so there is some haters, right? And they hate on Carmen because Carmen's a many men love Carmen because he's a man of good. And so these haters, they start they devise a plan, and they agree that they're gonna bear lying witness, and they're gonna tell the king that Carmen is that he's saying some stuff he shouldn't be saying. But then their agreement goes as far as covering like every detail. Like, okay, when the king asks for another testimony, I'm gonna call you up, and then you're gonna say this, and so everything was perfectly planned out. So surely enough, they go to the one goes to the king, and he starts lying, and the king wants to know if anyone else heard, and the dude, he's like, oh yeah, this individual over here, her, well, and the king responds, well, bring him over here to kind of like, to, I guess to find out if this is true. And so they bring the other individual, and the king is convinced that Carmen is a betrayer. And so Carmen, the king sends soldiers, you could say, some of his servants to kill Carmen and his family, to surround the house and completely kill him. This is what happens. Before that happens, the wicked them, the haters of Carmen, kind of like to play it cool, like if they're still cool with Carmen, because Carmen has no idea what's going on. They go to Carmen's house and they start drinking and they start speaking like good words to Carmen, you know, like kind of pretending nothing's going on, you know, common mistake, at least for the wicked them. What ends up happening, they get so wasted that they pass out in Carmen's house, and the angel of the Lord, Adonai, he appears to Carmen at night, and he says, get up, get your family and some of your servants, take as many riches as you possibly can, and head out, because the king just sent individuals to kill you. What ends up happening is that they take off by night, Carmen and his family, and they get separated, right? But before that, the individuals that were sent to kill Carmen and his family end up killing the lying witnesses, and so that Carmen could be. It is a reflection of karma, but karma would be the secular, the worldly view of Jah truth, you know. And so let us continue with the story. So Carmen ends up in a certain territory, Babylon, I believe, and so he's a loved individual, and so they set him up with the household, because a certain merchant is gone for like 3 years, and so Carmen takes residence in the merchant's home while he's absent, and so what ends up happening is that the this is also kind of like Moses, like Joseph's story, and kind of like Moses' story too, or the leading up to Moses, but I'm not saying it is, just I'm pointing out the similarities. And so like the merchant's wife, and she ends up being impregnated by Carmen, and because she knows she has sinned. I'm not sure if Carmen knows that. Well, anyways, yeah, because I'm not even gonna get into that. But what ends up happening is that the merchant's wife, having a child of a stranger, in this case being the Israelite Carmen, sends her handmaid to cast the baby out into the river, right, into the water, just like the whole Moses situation. And Pharaoh, I believe it's even as clear as saying that's in Babylon, that's happened in Babylon. And then Pharaoh, I believe, one of the daughters or one of the queens or something like that, she has a child, and it's a bird, you know, it's a perfect bird without wings. And that is even interesting, the whole Moses and the Ibes and the birds and the serpents, you know, and the lying testimonies and the exaltations and all that, but no wings, you know. I'm thinking that bird might have been humble. But anyways, continuing, so Pharaoh's queen or daughter, she sends her handmaiden to cast that child into, or that bird child into the water. And what happens is that they both put them in a box, and so that's even reflective of the ark. And when these two handmaidens, one has the goodly child, the child of the Israelite, and the other has the bird, the perfect bird without wings, and so They go to the river to dump the childs, to cast them into the river, the waters, and they meet each other. So one asks the other, what do you got there, you know, and it ends up being like the goodly child, And the handmaiden says, oh, what? Why would you do that? You know, why don't you keep them? And that other handmaiden asks the other handmaiden, the Pharaoh's handmaiden, or queen handmaiden, to what you got? And she brings out the bird, you know. And so what they do, they make a switch. That's even reflective of Joseph switching Ephraim and Manasseh, you know, if I even got that correct. Excuse me if I didn't. But so they make a switch, and what they do, they cast the bird, the perfect bird that has no wings, into the water. And then the Pharaoh's handmaiden, or the Pharaoh's daughter handmaiden, takes the goodly child. And that, you know, now that I think about it, that's almost exactly like what's being said in, that's exactly the story of Moses, right? I'm not sure if the time scale are properly, are aligned or anything, but anyways, I'm basing this on similarities, not as a, direct interpretation, so let I and I continue. And so they throw the perfect bird without wings into the water, and the Pharaoh's daughter's handmaiden takes the goodly child to Pharaoh's house, right? And what, you know, I just mentioned that because I'm, you know, it's a lot of ideas start popping up in Iman mind, and this kind of shines light into the mythology of so-called mythology of Egyptian beliefs or religion, you know, because it's like I'm thinking it gives I an idea of how Egyptians interpreted these so-called gods, you know, because a perfect bird without wings, I think it's like someone humble, you know, because it turns out that the goodly child is a mess. He thinks he's all bad. He ends up, I think, if I'm correct, he ends up like destroying the kingdom and stuff like that because he exalts himself and stuff like that. So I'm pretty sure there's some relativeness there. It relates somehow, but yeah, I just wanted to mention that because it's interesting. You know, it's not how the Gentiles they make it seem. You know, because the body of a man has the head of a bird, that's a god, and that it was a hybrid or whatever. I think it's more significant than anything else. And the whole idea of the bird and being saved on eagle's wings and stuff like that. So I just thought that was interesting. And so in Rastafari's biblical study number 46, in the prophets, you know, it begins with mentioning how this blessed one would be tied up with the elect, you know, and that's a direct reference to the diadem, to the crown. Like that's the crown that is being spoken. Like I and I are to be Yehoshua's or Yeshua's, the Mashiach, you know, the Messiah's wardrobe and garment. We're supposed to decorate him, you know, and so that's that. But I'm just gonna read a quick verse from Isaiah chapter 49, which is included in Rastafari's Levitical study number 46, and it has to do with the rock, with building on the rock. So it says, "Hearken to me." This is chapter 51, verse 1. "Hearken to me, listen, ye that follow after righteousness, ye that seek the Lord, Adonai even. Look to the rock whence ye are hewn, and to the hole of the pit whence ye are digged." So, you know, Lalibela definitely being, relative in this case. Now let us go to, you know, just to finish off, Hebrews chapter 11. This would be the New Testament reading. I just want to include that this verse is not included in the reading, but it's interesting for obvious reasons. "By faith Enoch was translated that he should not see death, and was not found, because God had translated him. For before his translation he had this testimony, and he pleased God." That's interesting, because a way of interpreting that is that Enoch was translated, right? So he was like a book even. So he didn't die, he was like kept guarded, you know, for all this time. And all of a sudden, you know, like even the Lion of Judah Society comes out, or brings out to the open the a translation, or you know, the Book of Enoch. You see, because he was translated since that time, because he had a certain testimony, and that testimony still lives to this day. But oh, that reminds that I think I have to go back to Isaiah chapter 40, 51 really quick. I apologize for that. I kind of forgot something. Verse 2 would be of chapter 51, book of Isaiah, prophets, the prophet reading, RSS 46. Look to Abraham, your father. Look to the ruler of many nations, to the leader of many nations, your father, Abba, even, and to Sarah that bare you, to Sarah, to the noble Africa, to the noble Ethiopia, even, not the ignoble regimes that are unhappy. For I called him alone and blessed him and increased him. You know, and I mentioned that because the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, is going to go into that, is going to make reference to Abraham. And so let us begin from verse 8. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should after receive for an inheritance, obeyed. So what are we to do? Obey. And he didn't know what he was going to receive. He didn't see it, but he knew he was going to receive it. And he went out not knowing whether he went. He just took off by faith. And so, by faith, he sojourned into the land of promise as a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked for a city which hath foundations, whose builder and maker is God. You know, that's Ethiopia. You know, Lalibela is built on one rock, it turns out, you know. If my resources are correct, one living rock. So imagine 12 churches, fairly distant from each other, from one rock, you know. And so from that from Petra's, you know, that big rock. And so it's funny because well, it's interesting because Petra's is a city, Pedros is a city in kind of like on the Gaza Strip. And they claim that the Ark of the Covenant was there, and there's even rock hewn. There's a rock hewn church. It's similar to. It's not similar. It's more like, I guess you could say, it's more like fancy design. It's more of a fancy design, but the I guess the root of the architecture, it's all Ethiopian, you know. But a little different, and they claim that the ark was there for a while, so it probably did pass through there. But that's that. And so, continuing verse 11, through faith also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed, and was delivered of a child when she was past age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. And so, the reason I included that is just to, I guess, because it corresponds to the reading. I don't think I'm gonna. Let's not go further. Well, I guess the main point I wanna stress upon. Well, I wanna, I guess, extract from this is how it's not only that we are to look to Ethiopia. I mean to Africa, but rather Ethiopia, because Africa, yeah, I mean, it's the goal, right? But more specifically, even Garvey failed to mention that it's not look to Africa, but more specifically look to Ethiopia, because we could look to some parts of Africa and you know, it could result in worshiping idols, you know. But so, let us not even look to, let's be more specific. Let us look to Imperial Ethiopia, you know, goodly Ethiopia in the days of His Majesty even. And so yeah, that's what I wanted to mention from Hebrews 11. And you know, these all, this is verse 13, these all died in faith, not having received the promise, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them, That's even, that could even correspond to the diadem, the crown, and the binding, you know, embrace them. And even Jacob, the heel grabber, you know, the binding, the grabbing, the holding on, the sustaining, the desire. So, continuing, embrace them and confess that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. For they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. And truly, if they had been mindful of that country from whence they came out, they might have had an opportunity to have returned. But now they desire a better country, that is, an heavenly. Wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he hath prepared for them a city. So let us end there, you know. You know, I feel no need to have to go into that, you know. But I pray I can receive what that is. But, you know, so that completes finally, you know, like so many days after the Shabbat, the Senbet. But give thanks for listening. Once again, if you feel that some of this information is useful, share it with because there's many LOJs out there that may not know that some of this information is out there to be received. And so go ahead and if the I so will, distribute some of this information. And you know, just want to make mention, I is working on something interesting. It's a calendar, and so I as Rastafari, we need one. I'll get something ready right now, and we'll get into it. So give thanks. Shalom. Let Jah be the guidance and protection of all and die.